What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Let's Play Dark Souls. Man, has it been a long time since I recorded. Gonna have to get the rust off quick, since today we are gonna hit up the Great Hollow. Just in the back here, a Blight Town, and then we're gonna be moving on to the Demon Ruins. Hopefully I can get through all of that and Lost Izalith today. Depends on how quick I am and how smoothly everything goes down in the Hollow. I'm not going to be exploring the Great Hollow too... I'm probably not going to be exploring the Great Hollow too much. There are... The word branching pathways is more appropriate here than perhaps it has ever been, since we're going to be inside a gigantic tree. Yep, this is it. I lied about all the exploration. This is the Great Hollow. Now we're done with this area. No, we're not. There is one more chest. Now we're done with it. Hit the wrong gesture. Oh well, meant to hit hooray. Since we're done with the Great Hollow. Oh god, we're not done with the Hollow again. So this is one gigantic series of branching pathways. Branches, in fact. Actual branches. I don't tend to explore this area too much, even though there are a lot of ways to traverse the level, because they all scare the hell out of me. And they all scare the hell out of me because, as I've said multiple times, I hate the prospect of falling to my death because of narrow-ass ledges. It's why I don't take too many risks on jumping off to get treasure or anything. There's one in particular that comes to mind. It was back when I was playing Demon Souls and I was in Lotria. It was Lotria 2. And it was it was leading down to, I believe, where you get the rune shield and the rune sword, the items that Estrava used. Never sure what's an invisible wall, so I tend to hit everything. It was down to get the rune shield and the rune sword. It was that one that I will always remember as being like the singular most scary treasure in that game. And then the shortcut leading down to Flame Lurker. I don't like drop downs in Souls games. They scare the shit out of me. Because when you land, you tend to take like a very small step forward and you can't just gently go off a ledge. Which is, if you've played the game, you know what I'm talking about when I say that. It's a little hard to describe how it feels, but it's kind of like that. When you jump, you go forward a few inches. You don't just drop straight off, which I guess physics-wise makes a little bit of sense. It'd be nice if you could like climb down and hang and drop straight, but no, you go in a little arc, and that horrifies me because I'm always afraid I'm gonna land a few inches off from a platform that I'm trying to land on and just die, so I tend to just avoid that always. Doesn't matter how many times I play the Souls games, it's still scary, even when I do go after that risky treasure. Risky treasure. Love that phrase. It's on this guy. It's just a soul. I believe I already missed the one piece of fairly significant treasure inside. It's back in the very first branch. There was a drop-off we could have made. I believe you could see the item flicker, the item glow. I can't really remember. It's been a while since I got it. I might come back here. Or is that it down there? Like, way down at the bottom. Ooh. Even that roll kind of scares me. Because the other thing is, like, some of the surfaces are... They look like flat, traversable terrain, but they're actually rounded and sloped, and you just can't see that. And even some of the stuff that doesn't look like that, it looks like the stuff that looks traversable, it's actually just a slope sometimes. And you'll land on it thinking, okay, I have a narrow pathway here, and you'll just slide off the edge and die. I hate that. No! And now I don't know from this branch where I am supposed to be going. And I can't get back up onto the platform. I'm really seriously considering homeward boning and starting over, because I made a drop off earlier in the tree because I wasn't paying attention that I normally don't make, and it's not the most straightforward path through the level that I've taken, which means this path that I have taken is one I am not as familiar with. There's a very quick straight path, or as straight as you can get with this tree, that leads directly through the level. And now that I have gone off that tried and true path, I have to take one that scares me a lot more than the ordinary path. The ordinary path, you just follow a few routes fairly straight down. You go as far to the bottom as you possibly can, and you make your exit. Here, I'm going to have to do some things that I don't necessarily like doing. Like, I'm going to have to be making a lot of these kinds of drops, which it's 5 feet, but the penalty for not making out onto the branch is dying. And there, with the path I'm going down now, I'm pretty sure there's, like, this one. Oh, no! Oh! God damn it. Okay. That was not good. It's stuff like that, where you'll hit, like, the rounded, sloped edge of a branch. God. Do I actually want to risk this again just to go after the might as well. Oh, that... fuck. Luckily, this... ooh. Don't drink in the curse fog. By the way, all those little stone shards, they look kind of like gray granite, almost obsidian flowers. They are the petrified remains of people who have been cursed. The basilisks, it's hard to see in game. If you look at their models, though, in like a model viewer or something, or if you look at the official artwork, those gigantic bulbous yellow eyes are not their actual eyes. They have much tinier, narrow, evil-looking eyes, a pair of them directly beneath the big bulbous ones. The treasure that I was talking about is, I think, right off of the first tree branch, but I got so scared by all the jumping around that I forgot to finish talking about that. It's the Cloranthy Ring, and it's a pretty simple drop-off to get to it, but it leads to a path that I didn't want to go down. The Cloranthy Ring, all it does is regenerate your stamina much more quickly. I don't think it's the best ring in the game. It's a really good ring, but the fact that stuff like the Dark Woodgrain Ring, Hovels, the Ring of Favor and Protection, just the fact that rings that are that overpowered exist in the game make it less than an ideal choice. Now, if I was going down the path that I normally take, the mushrooms here would almost form a spiral staircase, but since I'm on a different path now, I'm actually not sure where I'm supposed to go. I wanted to land on that mushroom, like roll or either jump onto that mushroom in front of me. The only reason I wasn't scared of shit to do that was because I knew I wasn't high enough to actually die from the falling damage that time. I had no guarantee mentally that I wasn't going to die from the last two serious falls, but I'm not even going to bother fighting the giant mushroom people. I'm just going to exit straight out into Ash Lake. This is one of the areas in the game that people really, really love, and I'll talk about that in a second since I talked so little about the Great Hollow. The Great Hollow is a gigantic arch tree. And arch trees, I believe, are supposed to either hold the various lands or hold, like, the entire world up. I guess they're supposed to have something like a Norse Yggdrasil theme going to them. But I'm not really sure, like, what other connections I can draw between that particular part of Norse mythology and the rest of the game and the arch trees. I'm not even sure if that's the right analogy to be making or the right reference that they were going for. And the arch trees have never really sat right with me. I've never really been able to figure out what the deal with them is, aside from just, like, random things I've read, like how they hold the world up. I don't even know that fact of what actually supports that. And we have another Hydra down here. He's a lot tougher than the one in Darker Basin, so I'm not going to fight him. I am especially not going to fight him because, as you can see, there's a lot more of those underwater cliffs to fall off of, and I tend to fall off and die in these a lot more often than when I fight the Darker Basin Hydra. They're a lot harder to see, outside of like this little area. Here you can see him pretty well. As you start going further out into the sandbar, it becomes deceptive where those cliffs are, and I'm trying to bait the Hydra into doing something here. There we go. Come on now. Come on, Hydra. Is he not gonna do it? There he comes. Is that the scariest shit ever? I damn near pissed myself the first time I saw him do that. And I screamed, oh, this is not fair. We have a couple clams in this area. We're gonna see the clams way more, and they're gonna be way, way more annoying after we're done Izalith and we head into the Duke's archives to finish off See the Scaleless. But a little bit more on the arch trees real quick, since we seem to be seeing a whole hell of a lot of them here. If these are arch trees, I mean, I'm assuming they are just because they're gigantic ass trees, but I don't know if there's some other criterion here. You can head inside of the one that I just passed. You can see the ramp leading up into it. I believe you come into an area with more basilisks and more mushroom people. I need another clam. Aside from the Cloranthy Ring, I don't think there's too much, like, really substantial treasure here. I think it's just mostly stuff that you can get in other areas without going through that much trouble. But what we're coming up to is something very interesting. As far as the arch trees go, I feel like I'm fairly ignorant of those, especially compared to... Oops, don't want to die here. He shouldn't be able to get any more shots off on me. I feel fairly ignorant about the arch trees. Like, I don't know that much about them, so if anyone in the comments wants to enlighten me with some information that isn't super common knowledge or some really cool theories about them, I would welcome it. Ash Lake itself is... I call these sandbars. I believe this is all supposed to be ash, hence the name Ash Lake, and this was probably a battleground where Gwyn reduced it to cinders. And man, that is the most evil, scary-looking enemy in the entire game, although he's not actually an enemy, just a mob. You can actually pray to him to join his covenant, which I will do because I'm a little covenant whore. I've been whoring it up with the covenants. I've joined everything so far except the Princess Guard covenant, which I forgot to join real quick just for the sake to say I get around like the town bicycle. And might not realize this, but you can come around behind him and cut his tail off, and it doesn't turn him hostile. It actually doesn't elicit any kind of reaction whatsoever, not even a real animation. Because the Everlasting Dragon, being the last of the true immortal dragons, does not feel pain. Anyway, though, we are going to enter yet another covenant after joining the Dragon Covenant. I'll talk about the Dragon Covenant and the Princess Guard Covenant in a bit, because I forgot to talk to them. But since I do have so much humanity, I'm actually going to offer 30 humanity up to the Fair Lady to hit rank 2 in the Covenant, so I can open the shortcut and do Slayer's Quest later. So I will be back in just a second after I have taken the time to give her all of this fucking humanity. Okay, this should be either last or second last. Which one is it? Damn it. Oh, never mind. Okay, so since we got the Pyromancy Chaos Storm, that indicates that we are now rank 2 with Covenant, which means that down the line in just about 5-6 minutes or so, give or take, should be able to open up the shortcut. I'm not going to be using the shortcut to go straight to Bed of Chaos, but I am opening it up just so I can do the last leg of Solaire's quest chain, which I've been working on. I wasn't initially planning on doing it, but since I got to this point with so much humanity, that is going to be no problem whatsoever. I would actually have way, way, way more humanity if it wasn't for those stupid deaths in Sen's Fortress from the very past coming back to haunt me. So if you kill these poor non-hostile infected guys up here whose heads have turned into huge egg sacs, a bunch of these maggots spawn out. And, ooh, they're pretty annoying to fight because they hit very quickly and they hit in a staggered fashion. They'll hit you one after another and kind of stunlock you. So I'm not going to be fighting them. They also have a breath spray attack that looks like a blood spray. That attack has a really interesting property to it. When they attack you with that, it infects you with the same parasitic egg sac that those carriers had. And you start off scratching your head, and then after a little while, it covers your head completely with an egg sac. And that infection gives you a new dialogue with Engi, and it'll give you new options with him. And I'll have to remember to come back for that later. When that happens, instead of gaining souls at a normal rate, the parasite takes half of your soul gains. Once that parasite gets 100,000 souls, it hatches into this creepy-looking worm, and it gets bigger as you get more souls, and your kick animation gets replaced with the worm biting, with the worm lunging out to bite. So what I'm doing right now is I'm gonna clear all of these mini Taurus demons. By the way, if you haven't played this, did you expect them to be making a return? That boss, rather? As a little common enemy? 7 of which are guarding one ember down here? It's gonna take a little while to clear these guys out, and you already know how the fight goes. It's just gonna be super repetitive for like 5 or 6 minutes, so I am gonna cut ahead to clearing the last one out and getting the ember. So I'll be right back in a second. Son of a bitch. I spent like 6 or 7 minutes clearing all that stuff out only to realize, no, I don't get to get my hands on the ember or the other treasure hidden here. Because this is all lava, it does way too much damage to me when I step into it for a bit just to pick the treasure up to stay there for a bit. So I have to wait until I get the orange charred ring 2 bosses from now to go back to get it. I can technically survive staying in the lava long enough to get it, but I don't want to take that chance. So I will be back in this area to get the ember and all that stuff later on in a little bit. Probably next episode, maybe at the beginning of the episode after. Not a big deal. You know where the ember is in this area. You just have to be able to get to it, which I'm a little not super confident about. So the Capron demons also make their return here. A lot of bosses at this point in the game start to recur as normal enemies, which is both cool and a little tiny bit lazy. I do like getting to fight more Capra demons just because I really like their design, I like their weaponry, and I like the way they behave. Like, I actually really like their moveset and stuff, and their AI. They're fun fights. It's just the first time you come up against a Capra demon, he's accompanied by 2 tiny-ass dogs, and it's like trying to have a knife fight in a phone booth. Oh, come on. Come to Butthead. Oh, no? Really? I don't want to try to fight them both at once because they tend to take a shit ton out of my stamina. Plus, they actually do a bit of knockback on their swings. So I would like to not get knocked off the cliff here. Okay, I can just walk up to this one. Come at me, bro. Come at me. Your stupid goat head. Or your cow head, cow skull, whatever that's supposed to be. Nah, I lied. It's a cool design. They have this really cool ridged tail, too, that I like. These ones, if they have one weakness, though, it's the fact that they're really easy to stagger. It only takes, like, 3 or 4 hits. So as long as you block or dodge their first hit without getting knocked away, and that leaping attack is the real attack that can knock you far enough back, which means you only really have to wait for one more attack to start swinging and stagger them. Really easy to stagger. Let's see, I know there's the one on the right hiding behind a pillar, so I want to draw this one out anyway. Dude. Wait, is that a 3-hit kill? I haven't been really paying attention. I think with 2-handing, it's a 3-hit kill. 1-handed looked like 4. Unless, like, I've had some kind of aneurysm and I can't count, which seems likely. I thought they had a lot more health than that. These are some of the least threatening enemies ever. They die in like 4 hits. And they get knocked back and staggered really easily. There's a treasure. This is a soul, isn't it? Yeah. I always know where they place the souls based on how obvious the corpse is. There is a little bit of treasure over here that I almost forgot about. I had my eyes on the Foggate prize. Oh, I think this one is a pyromancy. There's another one that I thought this was. I thought this was the other ember. These guys are really tough. Like, surprisingly tough. They knock you back, they take a ton out of your stamina, they have that corrosive breath style attack. They do a lot of damage to you if you don't block them too. And they have a lot of health, but their one true weakness is that they are totally immobile. They're just stuck in the wall. Oh god, they look like, you know what they look like? They look like giant engorged house centipedes. Fuck. Ugh. Hate them. Ugh. God damn it. Centipedes are terrible. Yeah, this is a pyromancy, right? No, this is a soul, damn it! I was tricked. And he was, the bonfire just appears under his belly. So, oh, and I am lucky that this bonfire is here, because I do in fact want to be human, so I don't miss another encounter with Dark Wraith Kirk. Because I kept forgetting to show him off before. Well, I didn't keep doing it. I forgot to be human so that he could invade me one time in the depths. Unfortunately, that's going to screw me out of getting his armor set. And these guys respawn. Oh, right. So while I'm going back through the respawn Capra Demon enemies, to recap the deal with Dark Wraith Kirk, even though he's called Dark Wraith Kirk, he is confirmed to be a member of the Chaos Covenant. And he invades you at 3 points throughout the games, assuming the bosses of the areas in which he invades you are still alive when you go through them. And of course, you have to be human, sir. The name is Human. You have to be in human form, not hollowed, in order to get invaded, even by NPCs. So, I was not human when I was going through the depths. That's one of the areas where he invades you. It's in the bottom floor of the depths when you're going through the sewers. It's the basilisk area around there. You kill him once there when he invades you. He invades you again here in the demon ruins, right at the base of where we came in here, right before we started fighting all of these Capra demons. And he invades one more time somewhere in Lost Izalith. I can't exactly remember. Oh, he invades you, I think, right outside of the boss fog to Bed of Chaos, where you're fighting a different NPC while he invades you. And if you kill him all three times, then you can go to, I think, the area behind where the Fair Lady is, and you can find all of his armor there. Now, I had to backtrack through the Capra Demons to get him to spawn. I wish he would have invaded me from a better spot where I didn't have to re-clear enemies. Where is he? This is normally where he invades me. Well, I'm gonna be pissed if for some reason he just chooses not to. That can happen. I've been missing a bunch of invasions because I always forget to unhollow. Oh, that's weird that there's a boss fog in the way. Buddy finally decided to show up. Now, which side is he coming from? Oh, there. The deal with his armor is that when you take a swing at him, it kind of hurts you. His shield bash, I think, does abnormally high damage. Actually, it's the size of a small shield or a medium-sized shield, but its special property is it has an attack animation like a shield bash normally would. And you get a bit of stuff from his bode. Now, oh, didn't mean to aggro that Capra demon. Now we can actually go back to making forward progress. Now that Dark Wraith Kirk is vanquished for the time being. So somebody asked me, I think it was Nate, what my top three levels are. And it's really hard to pick because I want to just give the cop-out answer and say that the entire world is my favorite. Like, the entire world because of how impressively connected everything is and how cool it is just as a whole. But if I have to pick three, I don't know. The choices that really do it for me the most are probably going to be the ones with a ton going on in terms of either traps or atmosphere. So, with that in mind, top three is probably Sen's Fortress, Painted World, and New Londo in no particular order. In fact, New Londo is probably my favorite of those three. I also really like the Undead Burg, even though it's the starter level and the easiest one in the game. I like the Depths a lot, too. I like Blighttown a lot, which is going to be another shocker for people. Like, the question originated because Nate was really surprised to hear that I love New Londo so much. Blighttown is another one that I like a lot. It doesn't really touch how much I like the Valley of Defilement, but still. Anor Londo is another really good one. Maybe Anor Londo is top three. Maybe it replaces Sens. I don't know. I like aspects of Darkwood, too. I like the DLC areas, too. The only problem with the DLC areas is there's too tiny, so there isn't a lot of room for much to be going on. Even Ulysil Township, which is the biggest area, doesn't have a ton going on, because it's not that big. Catacombs has some cool features, too, including some really neat, well-hidden shortcuts and items. Plus, the Gravelord Covenant, the way you access that, I think is awesome. Just have to get through a couple more of these guys, by the way. I think it's the Ember or the Pyromancy I was thinking of before back here. What other levels do I like, come to think of it? This is gonna kind of contradict what I was saying and complaining about before, but even the Tomb of Giants I really like in theory. And going through in the dark and just seeing these faint, tiny blue dots etched into the darkness is really ominous. It's really dreadful. And it makes it really tense and frightening. And the monster designs, even especially those skeletal dog beasts, are fucking radical. Actually, Tomb of Giants on its own merits is one of my three favorite levels, just taking it on its own merits. But I think the only problem with it is that it's poorly set up. I think you actually need a little bit of information going into it, and the game doesn't impart that information well. That's, I think, the only thing really wrong with it that makes it frustrating to go through. Duke's Archives is another one I like, which is coming up later after I do Izalith. Duke's Archives is really cool, but something about the rooms with the rotating staircases confuses the shit out of me, because spatially, it never makes sense to me. Because I'll clear a floor out, and I'll go to the rotating steps and hit the lever to flip the staircase, and I'll do that for a bit and exit onto a floor with a chest of open, a bunch of corpses, but the exit to that part of the level will suddenly be there, and it just spatially messes me up. Like, it seems like you're exiting out onto a floor that you've already been on, except it's somehow not. It's either that, or once you start rotating the stairs around, the exit opens up from the wall, and the exit is on a floor you actually have already been on. You just need to activate some. I don't know how that works, even though I've done it a bunch of times, but it destroys my spatial reasoning. Maybe it's something that I'll grasp a little better after I do it for the Let's Play. If not, though, I will point out once again why it messes me up so bad. And it's not like I get so confused and turned around that I can't figure out my way out of the fucking level, but it's just, it doesn't make sense in my head, and that really hinders my ability to enjoy it. The way we're headed right now is the way you get to the shortcut. It's directly to the right of the boss fog leading to the demon Firesage, I think he's called. You know what else I hate about the Duke's Archive? The fucking stupid-ass clams after the Crystal Cave. You'll see the clams and what I mean about them. The clams themselves aren't bad. It's the fact that when you enter Seath's boss room for the actual fight against him, the first time you do that, it's all in a cutscene. There's no actual boss fog in the way the first time you go to fight him. So you enter the boss area, a cutscene plays, and the clams can actually enter the boss room with you and get trapped inside with you. So you actually have to work to not get sabotaged by the stupid fucking clams. That, the other thing I don't like about Duke's Archive is the fact that when you first encounter Seath, I'm not going to spoil what happens, but... Well, I'm not going to spoil what happens. There is something really bullshitty that I will remember to bring up later. When you go through the shortcut here, you see all these chaos bugs. One of them has glowing eyes. That's one that you absolutely need to kill. If you want to do Solaire's quest, that one will drop this item, which is the Sunlight Maggot. It's a helmet that emits light, so just like the cast light spell, it gives you a constant source of light that doesn't require you to replace a weapon or a shield to hold up to get that light. So that comes in handy to do the Demon Ruins and get rank 2 in the Covenant before... Actually, you don't need rank 2 in the Covenant just to get the Sunlight Maggot. You need rank 2 in the Covenant to do all of this before Solaire's quest. Because the deal with the Sunlight Maggot is you eventually wind up finding Solaire down here, and the Sunlight Maggot will drive him insane. If you do not kill it before you enter the Izalith area. And this is pretty much just a reskin of the Stray Demon and of the Asylum Demon. I'm trying not to screw this up too much. Ooh. Let's see. To kind of cap off for the time being what I was saying about the levels and all the levels I really like, I complained a little bit about features I don't like about Duke's Archives. For the most part, I like that level. As far as levels that I hate, though, you're gonna see why this coming up is my least favorite level in the game. Overall, I like or love most levels, or at the very least, I like the ideas behind some. Izalith, boy, can this whole level fuck right off. Also, I shouldn't be complaining this much about Izalith yet, because I think it's going to get me killed against a really easy boss. So maybe I should pay attention. The only thing that makes this boss a little bit of a pain in the ass sometimes is because it's, the room is very long and open in one dimension, but it's a narrow hallway of a boss arena. So if he gets himself into a position where he's backed against a wall, I always try to roll behind him to avoid the AoE, and it just, the side of it, the very side of the hitbox catches me. So every now and then I'll have a really stupid death on this boss, but he's actually not bad at all. It's just, even when you block the magic attack, unless maybe you're using a crush shield, it still does a super high amount of damage, and then obviously unblocked, it does way, way more. But I should not be dying to him. I shouldn't even be taking as much damage as I did. That's going to be the fight, though. Next episode, since this has gone so long, we will pick up with the rest of Izalith, and I will go into detail with why I hate this level. Thank you guys for watching. Take it easy. Have a good one.